one. Right, episode 3. Now, last week we had Luke Gayle, Super League player, Man of Steel, but this week I've brought you a completely different gravy. If you're from my era, I'm from Morley. You know, everyone knows I'm from Morley. Leeds United is key. You know, over here, where we are now in Pontefract, it's a big rugby league area, but where I'm from in Morley, Leeds United, it just runs through the blood. So today we've got Tony DiRigo, best left back they've ever had, championship winner. Welcome to house. Thank you so much for coming.
More than welcome.
It's a total privilege to have you here, and wow, I can't believe you're here.
Good to be here. Good to be here.
That's what it's all about. And obviously, want to talk to you about championship when you won it.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, we've been putting it on Facebook and stuff like that, that you're coming. So a lot of my mates have been like, bloody hell is going on about Tony DiRigo, this, Leeds United, that. Obviously, Leeds United are in the middle of going up. You know, we're hopefully going to go up this year.
I like the way you said that, going up.
We are going up.
We're going up.
Can't go on forever. So, but what I wanted to ask you, first question really was, do you actually realise how in esteem people hold that era, that team? You know, Tony DiRigo, Mel Sterling, Chris Fairclough, David Batty, Gary Speed. Do you still remember it? Is it still inside you?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think during that season especially, obviously you're trying to win the big things, but as you're in the middle of it all, you don't realise it until probably afterwards what you've actually done. And then the feeling that, you know, the fans have given us year after year after that has been incredible. I think the difference for me especially, probably recently, is that the club now have really welcomed me and other ex-players back even more. Not so they didn't before, but now especially with the new owner, he's been absolutely fantastic. So we've come back, because before I was getting invited by Chelsea. You know, Stoke City, Aston Villa, Derby, all my other clubs trying to get me back, and Leeds, not so much. And where I wanted to go was back to Leeds. So recently I moved back to the city, and Andrea called me up and says, can you come and open the Legends Lounge? About 2 years ago this was. It was fantastic. And everyone around the club has been wonderful. Of course, things are going well now. But yeah, it's lovely to be back, and it's nice to be remembered, you know, in a great period.
Obviously, I know a lot about Tony DiRigo. I used to go, you know, 12, 13, 14, 15-year-old, go down Welland Road with my dad. You're one of my dad's favourite players. I used to sit right outside at dugout. So there'd be Peter Gumby, Mick Hennigan, Howard Wilkinson. Peter Gumby's a customer of mine.
All right, very good. He still comes in.
He texts me for a pint now and again in Leeds. We drift off and talk about football and stuff, because that era, I'm really enthusiastic about. I know for a fact when Leeds United were playing towards Kop, you were always at our side because you were left back. Why did you always wear long sleeve shirts at Leeds United? But when you played for England, they were always short sleeve. Why?
Because I couldn't get a long sleeve for England. That was why. I like long sleeve. I don't know why. It's one of my.
You used to wear Asics boots as well.
I did. They were kangaroo skin. They were. Yeah, that's why I could jump so high.
Do you know something as well? I were from. My mum and dad did the very, very best for us, but you know, like. I thought, bloody hell, they're good, them boots. I always played rugby. And I was talking to my mate about it this week, Rob Davis. There used to be a catalogue come round it. I think it was called M&M. And it was like top quality football boots. Right. You know them boots were 200-odd quid all that time ago?
Yeah, because they were actually in limited edition from Japan. And they were really, really light.
You and Batty and McAllister all wore the same boots. Batty at one point wore Brooks ones. I don't know, sponsor. Yeah. But they even
I think
boots,
Speedo. Speedo, I think, wore Asics as well.
Yeah.
And the actual factory was near Leeds Bradford Airport.
Well, I definitely couldn't have a pair. I definitely couldn't have a pair. But my mate Rob, he was spoiled, and even he couldn't have a pair. But
they weren't cheap. They weren't
cheap.
You still
got any?
I haven't. But what you used to do is get like a size too small as well. And get them and just stretch them a little bit. Yeah. So we end up, I'm like a size, what, 7 or 8 now. I'd get a 6 and squeeze into them. They'd stretch slightly.
I was really surprised because, like, obviously I've been doing a bit of research this week on some stats and stuff like that. I could have swore you scored more goals for Leeds than what you did.
You know what? It's not about quantity, it's quality.
Do you know something?
That's what it's all about.
You know why I thought you'd scored a lot more?
Why?
Because when you scored one, My dad went on about it for about 14 games afterwards. So in my mind, Ego scored a few goals.
He had to go on for 14 games because he didn't score another one for a long time.
You had a good left foot. You used to do some good free kicks and stuff.
Yeah, I think, back to the championship winning side, I scored three times. One was a half volley.
That were against
Man City.
In a yellow kit.
Exactly, yeah. Right. But Bat scored.
Sweet volley, that.
Bat scored the same day.
Yeah, they did. He just did a little put and he hadn't scored for about 5 years.
Exactly. It was some little tap-in thing. I've just belted at 25 yards. The flippin' cop was coming down. I thought there was an earthquake or something when Bat scored. Because he's a local lad. Honestly, it was fantastic. But I'm thinking, hello? Do you remember my goal?
You know, Samo, my dad used to do as well. My dad used to, like, in that team, there were you, Mel Stirland, Gary McAllister, Gordon Strachan, all good at taking free kicks. Mm-hmm. So if any of them other three took a free kick and missed... Every time, should have let Dorigo take it.
I knew it.
What did I tell you? I told you it should have let Dorigo take it. And that, but if they ever scored, I'd say, hey, I bet you're glad he didn't take that one. He'd just tell me to show him.
Your dad's a very smart man, I have to say.
I thought he was a genius at football, but what he used to do, any attacking position whatsoever that Leeds United have, he'd say, they're going to score here. You watch, they're going to score here. And when they did score... You're like, what did I tell you? But it took me till I was about 15 to realise. He just said it every free kick, every attack, and any attacking position Leeds had, he'd say, they're going to score on them and the sky. Say, what did I tell you? Come see your dad. I know my football.
Actually, that's like I did a thing for Ladbrokes recently, and I had to meet a fan who put on some money in the championship winning year. She bet on us to win. I'm thinking, wow, that's amazing. That's fantastic. You know, how much did you put on? Fiver. But, well, you weren't that confident, were you? Was it just that year? No, I do it every year. So, well, it's not lucky then, is it? You're just putting a fiver on every year. But she wants some money anyway, so that's all right.
It's been tough being a Leeds fan over years, you know, since the decline. Like, I had the joy of being a fan when you lot were really, really good. And also the European ride, everything that went with that. But I can remember saying to my dad, you know, bloody hell, Dad, when they went down, how long do you think it'll be? And he went, it'll be 5 years, son. 5 years, it's a right mess. And what are we now, 15?
I think it's 15, yeah.
It's been, you know, like, that's why I say they are going up. Because if you look at any type of negative feeling about what's happened with Leeds over the years, it's been tough being a Leeds fan when I can remember it being really good. I think for my age, I'm 38, I've had some really good experience with Leeds United. I mean,
well, at least you've had ups and downs. Yeah, that's the thing. Unfortunately, yeah. we're on a bit of a downer now. But
well,
I think
they're
as well,
coming back now, aren't
no,
they?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Were Ken Bates, take you back to when you were at Chelsea, were Ken Bates the chairman then?
He was.
Didn't like him, did you?
We got on great, me and Ken.
Did you?
Not. problem was, I at Chelsea, when I signed for them from Aston Villa, we had some really, really good players. But Ken... thought he was the manager. Basically, he had so much input into things he shouldn't have done. So he affected the group. The manager was John Hollins, so he would affect us. And it's easy to say, well, you know, you shouldn't allow that to happen, but there's no choice. You know, he had such an effect on the club. And we could do well, or then we could do very, very badly. And I just thought, okay, we might win 6 or 7 on the trot, we then go lose 4 or 5, and something would happen in the background for that to then all go wrong. So I just wanted to leave. After about a couple of years, I thought, right, I want to leave. Glasgow Rangers had tried to sign me month on month on month. I went in to see Ken Bates, asking for a transfer. That was interesting. I wrote a letter out and took it in with me and sat down and explained to Ken for about 20 minutes, you know, all the reasons why I thought we couldn't be successful. Because what did I want to do? I wanted to win something. Or you always want to think you could win something. If I was ever at a club that I thought they don't think they can win, then what am I doing there? You always want to be the best, whatever it is. So anyway, so I did this for 20 minutes with Ken. He got my contract, turned it over, and said, by the way, Tony, I think you've got 2 years left. There's the deep door. That's what he said to me.
And you just
I got up and I said, I will never sign for this club again, and walked out. So I had to stay about a year and a half. They offered me this and that and the other.
And were you not playing?
Yeah, I played every game. I played every game. They would try to get me into a new contract, but they knew the character that I was. I'm not going to not play. They needed me, so I played for England, so I kept playing. But I just waited my time. Contract ran out. I was off.
Talking of writing letters, I went right back to when you even come over here. That's how you got here, isn't it? You wrote letters to clubs just saying, listen, I'm a good footballer, do you want me? Because you're Australian, obviously. And that's like a bit of a entrepreneur in itself, isn't it? Having the bottle. Did you just leave your mum and dad and just come over here? That's it.
I basically wrote a letter. I only had one thing in my mind. I went to, imagine going to school, and your teacher says to you, Tony, now, three professions, what would you like to do? Number one, two, and three. And this is an Aussie kid from Adelaide, and I put professional soccer player number one. I'm thinking number two. Professional soccer player, three professional soccer player. That's all I could see. That was it. And they're going, Tony, don't be stupid. You know, you're never going to be able to do that. Well, I thought I could. And if you don't think you can, then you definitely won't. So I wrote a letter to the top 12 clubs at the time in the old First Division. Leeds weren't in that top 12 at that point. And I got one reply from Aston Villa. So I was 15 years of age and they gave me a four-day trial. I came over with my dad for 4 days to Birmingham. And that was it. 2-3 weeks later, they signed me as a schoolboy. Year after, I was as an apprentice. Year after that, early as a pro, 17 and a half. And 18, I was in the first team.
Bloody hell. But obviously, with teams you've played for, and you don't, you can tell me truth here, don't you? Is Leeds your team? Just you're from Australia, you know, it's not like me. I have to support Leeds. If I had to support Leeds, I'd have been... If I had to come home and said, well, as it goes, then I want to support, like, anyone, like Liverpool, it'd have been, well, just get your stuff and get out.
Well, I'll tell you a true, true story here. Now, I was from Adelaide. I supported Adelaide City, my local team. Okay. My father is Italian. My mother's Australian. Now, my father's born from... Udinese, so that's the team that he supported, but he then supported an English side. And he kept telling me for years it was Leeds United. And I, so my father, being an Italian, supported Leeds United. Why? Because he went out to Australia late 60s, early 70s, and of course Leeds were always on the TV, and he fell in love with their style. He was quite a strong player himself. He played as well. But I was laughing at him at the time because Leeds weren't right up there, you know, when I started kind of coming through. And lo and behold, to then turn it all around, to come to Leeds, to win the title with my dad's team, which is just... It's bizarre. It's absolutely bizarre. It really is. So now I look back at all the teams I played for. Aston Villa, I'm so grateful they gave me my chance. A wonderful, wonderful club. Chelsea, they're not the club... that they are now. When I was there, fans were so diehard and, you know, wonderful, but just outside the club for me was the problem. But I enjoyed it. The last couple of years, it was you know, a bit more difficult. But again, we won the old second division title. I scored a winner at Wembley in one of the cup finals, so I have great memories of that. But Leeds is where I was really successful, and it certainly is. I always look for Leeds first, absolutely.
Yeah, good. I mean, I was looking. I was doing a bit more research, and like when you were at Chelsea, you got player of the year.
Mm-hmm.
When you were at Leeds United and the one title, you were player of the year, which a lot of people won't know that. Before I found out that fact, I'd have hazarded a guess at Gordon Strachan or something. But didn't you get player of the year at Derby as well?
I actually got player of the year at Torino.
Torino,
and Aston Villa, my first club as well.
Do you speak Italian, mate? Do you learn all right over there? I do now.
I learned, obviously, all the swear words first. It's always helpful, that is, when you go over. All the swear words, then the football words. I was only there for 1 year with Graham Souness at Torino. But had a fantastic experience. But I was fortunate. A fullback to get player of the year at kind of every club. When I got to Derby...
Yeah, fullback to get player of the year. That's what I say, you know, you were a very consistent... good player for Leeds, and it's good that now they've got you back. I see a lot of photographs on hospitality, blah, blah, blah. And they do have, that's why I say to you, like, do you understand? Because if me and you went for a pint in Marley now, within 25 minutes, it would have got round, and every pub would be full. There he goes in Queens.
But it's good. And that's why I look at Leeds and the city itself, and the fans, and the owners now, and everyone associated with the club. I'm thinking, oh, come on. Premier League, you know, that's where we got to be.
Oh.
We got to be in the Premier League, and I'm excited this season.
There's nothing quite like the atmosphere at Elland Road. I mean, one of my best mates, he supports Man City, so he says, "Listen, I got a spare ticket. Will you come with us?" And I went with him. I've only ever been to Headingley for rugby league and Ellen Road for football. And I was shocked. I'm like, what's up with them all? Leeds United's like a, it's just mental, isn't well, it? When
well,
they get it going?
Well, it's funny. It's like when I end up going to Derby. And Derby, a lovely club, but they're supporters. You know, you just, you listen to the songs that they sing. And then I never forget this one song, whatever game we were playing, you know, and all the fans are there and they go, let's go, Derby, let's go. I'm thinking, oh, come on, let's do something a bit more than that. That's not going to get me going. You know, right? Whereas Leeds, they want to rip your head off.
Leeds,
that's
what it just makes, that's what it
want.
Makes airs on back of your neck stand
exactly.
up. And,
has to.
Do you know what I mean? I'm at moment, I can't tell no lies, I work on Saturdays, me, and I don't go to a lot of Leeds United games because I'm just like work orientated. But I am hunting upside down for a ticket for Villa game end because to be at Ellen Road, and it's about the Villa game where we'll know if we're up or not, and it's looking tight. But I mean, we're still sitting pretty. But the atmosphere, and I mean, I've moved over to Pontefract from Morley, but I guarantee you, on the day that Leeds United are announced that they're going up to the Premiership, I will be on Cherwell Hill. It'll be absolutely nice. I can remember when the WANT title, me and my mates were all in park, we were like running around, we nicked a bed sheet, and we went down to Welland Road. And I mean, what did you lot do that night when you won? Did you have a party somewhere or something?
Well, the thing is, that day, I was on the Sunday.
Because you could have had the freedom of the city. You could have done anything you wanted, couldn't you?
Me and Bats had to go with England.
Oh.
We were supposed to then travel and play Russia. And so we were playing a friendly over in Russia. So I was on my way down to my in-laws and then going down to meet up with England. Bats was ready to do the same on the Monday. We get a phone call from Howard Wilkinson that night. So 4 or 5 hours after, obviously the result went our way and we'd won the title. He was half cut. To be fair, so was I. And we had this mumbling conversation and he said, Tony, don't worry, you don't have to go to England if you don't want. I've talked to the manager. You can stay and celebrate with the rest of the lads. You know, I've talked to Bats as well. I said, right, I'm staying. And that was it. So I had to get in my car and whiz back to Leeds. So Monday, then we all met up and had a, yeah.
My wife's dad, Eric, who's passed away also, he used to sell alt scarves, hats, you know, all that stuff outside Lowfield Roads Tunnel and also on that pitching outside Peacock Pub.
Yeah.
And he was telling me, like, so when the WANT title, lad, you could have had all you want. You know, like, when I started going out with Sam, he says, that year the WANT title, you could have all you want. He said, we went on 5 holidays that year.
it was
so
incredible.
And that's why if we do go up to, you know, when we get up to the Premiership, it'll be just so good for City, it'll be good for hotels, it'll be good for everything. It's Leeds is
right.
A destination.
No, it is, and I think if we are the third biggest city in England. If you think of all the businesses moving in, and I've been away and I've come back in the last couple of years, the centre of Leeds is fantastic. Where is there a city with so much quality in a compact, you know, environment? It's wonderful. So, yeah, I think as soon as we do go up, wow. It's going to absolutely take off. And I'm thinking we're already sold out every week. The club shop is doing crazy numbers. The fans, the sponsors, it's brilliant. When we get up, imagine what's happened.
We went this week to get 5 Evening Post retro kits for you to sign in a minute. And I got talking to the lad in there because, as you can imagine, I talk a bit. And
no way.
He says, this club shop now takes more than Man City one now. So imagine what they'll do. Because I noticed there were, I always look about retail stuff and I'm like, there's 29 tills in here. 29. I went, do you open them all ever? He went, on match day, every single one's flying and the queuing out of the door. He says, you like that? It's unbelievable. Like, can I ask you another question, right? If you explain this, how come, if you were a big billionaire guy now, why would you not pick Leeds before any other? Why? I don't get it.
Now, I think you're right. Now we are so ripe. I think if you go back a few years, clearly the issues underlying and underpinning the club, we had so many issues, did we not? What, you know, why are we where we are? The owners that we've had and how we got rid of the stadium and this, that and the other.
Just puzzling.
It is. But now I think we've got an owner that's put proper structure in place, bought the ground back. You know, the brand now is all very, very important. He understands. You know, he listens to the fans as well. I think if you're Not that he wants to sell, and I hope he certainly doesn't. Mm. But you're quite right. Any billionaire now, I'd be thinking, oh, that's the one for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
and I know what kind of Newcastle people are trying to buy Newcastle and what that's looking at going for. I'm thinking, are you kidding me? Leeds. Leeds.
When Leeds were in state of, you know, real bad times at Leeds, mm-hmm. I cannot work out why some... that say the guy who owns Man City, mm-hmm. money's no object to him. Anybody... I mean, like the guy who bought Leicester. Who, in the right mind, would buy Leicester before Leeds? I don't get it.
And look what he's done, though. I mean, he's but he's come in and helped the city. Absolutely amazing. But you're right. But I think
not against any other team, Leicester or anybody who's been taken over. But I just look at it from a business point of view. And if there were a club in country that I were going to buy, it'd be Leeds United. Mm. End of. Mm. That'd be it. But, and that isn't because I'm a Leeds fan. Mm. It's just, there's even room for development at side at ground, there's run down. It's just ripe for absolute development. It puzzles me.
But I think if you go back 15 years and the people that kept coming in, they probably thinking the same thing, that, you know what, I can easily make a bit of money here. And they did make some money, but nothing was, I think, for the long-standing health of the club. Absolutely not. So now I think we've got that happening. And that's really important, because the value of, imagine we go up, the value of our club is going to be worth God knows what. And as a brand, I mean, Bournemouth, okay, they're in the Premier League, you know, can they suddenly light up all their fans around the world? No, they can't.
Can they?
They haven't got any. We have. You don't realize. We've got them all around the place. So
I'm working in my shop in Leeds, on match day, the amount of foreign people, I mean, we're really big in like Norway, Iceland, Republic of Ireland, Northern Ireland. There's loads and loads of people on a day out round Leeds that are just, because we have a scarf at shop, this and over, and they're like, Leeds United, Leeds United. We have a bit of crap with them. You won't believe how big it is, Leeds United.
No, absolutely.
And talking of value, I'm not going to put you on spot here because it's not a fair question, but what I want the viewers to text in, how much on today's market does a 25-year-old Tony DiRigo command as, one, value in signing him, and two, what's he worth in getting paid?
I think I won't
ask that to you. Because
don't ask me.
Really,
however, if anyone would like to buy me or pay me that amount of money, I'll pass on my number willingly. No problems at all. Even give me a tenth of it. It's absolutely fine.
Leeds signed you for $1.3 million.
Bargain.
I'd never, ever, ever ask like what your wage is. Well, it's not fair that, but when you look at some of the players today, do you ever just think to yourself, bastard?
Something like that, yeah. I don't want to swear. Mother, could you not have waited a little bit longer or something? Yeah. You know what? I look back now and I don't actually think like that. In reality, I really don't, because I just...
No, you've got to be looking for what you've had, I suppose.
No, exactly. I'm delighted with what I have. And a lot of people, same sort of thing with the money side of things, but some people talked to me about England caps and said, and then Stuart Pearce. And Stuart Pearce, good friend of mine, but I don't look like that either. You only got 15 caps. Only. I am delighted I got 15 caps. You know, I feel very...
Let me tell you
something.
Proud
for 15 caps, not that I could have got 67.
You not being in the England team was the butt of many of argument in our household, because we used to be there and, like, the announced team, it would be like, say, Peter Shilton, Paul Parker, number 3, Stuart Pearce. And when they named Stuart Pearce, instantly, my dad would be like, I don't believe it. They've picked him again, Stuart Pearce. He's shit. He's not as good as DiRigo. And let me tell you this. Let me tell you now, he never even smiles. What's him smiling got to do with playing for England?
Your dad is smart.
You know what? He's passed now, but even when he scored against Spain in that penalty shootout, my dad turned around. Everybody else in country is running like this. My dad says, he's lucky, because if it were for me, he wouldn't even beat team. DiRigo beat team.
Brilliant.
You're not even English, he's Australian. But I used to watch England games in the other room, because that was butt of conversation, unless you were playing, of course.
Obviously.
Who were nicest manager you ever played under?
Nicest manager? God, I played under a lot of different ones. Bobby Robson was wonderful.
Have you watched that documentary on Netflix about him?
I haven't.
Brilliant. There's a film about him called, it's just called Robson. And obviously, football's terms, I just I just support Leeds. I know about Leeds and I watch a bit. But I watched that, and what a lovely, lovely man he was. And I tell you what, it's worth a watch if you're a football fan, on just the fact of, like, how successful he was. Like, you were a successful player, and it's a lot of it's under radar. That man, what he did at Barcelona.
Well, Barcelona, exactly. Wow. With England. And I think the respect that we all had for him was just amazing. He gave me my first cap. But just how he made you feel important and valued and wanted was tremendous.
I mean, he found the original Ronaldo, didn't he? Like, he went and found him, brought him. That Robson documentary, if you're a football enthusiast, which I'm a rugby league man, I'm not going to lie to you, but I do follow football. I'm not as bothered about it now, but when I were a kid and stuff, I was right into... But that era, I mean, like, imagine if he'd have been in charge of Paul Gascoigne for all of his life. He just knew how to deal with people, didn't he?
He did, but when you mentioned Paul Gascoigne, I think no one could deal with Gazza. I room with him.
It's a shame, isn't it?
Once, because... never again.
Never.
Joking, an absolute nightmare. And there's no... And I can't tell you all those stories, but I think Gazza was incredible. He was the best player that I've ever played with, absolutely. Natural talent, you know, by a long way. When you've got the best players in the country with England, you know, training together, and you see someone has more time and more space and his head and shoulders above everyone else. He was incredible. But I know what you mean in that. If someone got the best out of him and he could look after himself in the right way for that 10-12-year period, he would have been one of the, you know, the best
in
the world.
I once read a bit about Alex Ferguson. I mean, I know a lot of Leeds fans hate Alex Ferguson, I understand, but he actually went on vacation, presuming he'd signed Paul Gascoigne, didn't he? Yeah. So he'd literally said to Paul Gascoigne, said to his agent, everything, it were all nailed on, right, shall I go on holiday, Charter? You know, you definitely got him signed, haven't you? He's definitely coming. Everything were agreed verbally. He went on holiday. And while he went on holiday, Gazza went down to Tottenham. Tottenham bought his mum and dad a house or something, I believe, and said it'd be a great investment, and they signed him. And it'd be just interesting to see what Gazza would have been like under somebody like him's guidance.
I think it would have been his biggest challenge.
Yeah.
Fergie managed characters really well, but Gazza would have been something else. But we'll never know. Never know, but what a player.
Did he ever come sniffing round you, Ferguson? Because he liked every other good Leeds player.
Manchester United looked at me years and years ago when I was at Aston Villa. Instead of that, I went to Chelsea.
You wouldn't have been able to come here today if you'd have ever played
for them. I understand. Isn't that lucky? That's very fortunate. I saw the light eventually and I came to the right place. All good.
You wouldn't have been doing hospitality at Elland Road now if you'd played. I mean, you know something? My old man didn't fully trust Gordon Strachan because he'd played for them. He liked McAllister, but
there was something about Strach that wasn't quite right.
I'll tell you what, he was a good player, though.
A great player.
Well, that's what Leeds need now, in my opinion. Somebody at that age, you know, would be good to come back to Leeds now and be the perfect... And
Milner.
Yes.
There you go.
Yes,
I could see that
exactly
one.
Exactly what I was going to say.
I could see that one all day long. Hernandez now is doing a job now with that experience and quality for this side. But you're right, when we...
The lad who works
League.
With me, Ashley, his sons play at Horsforth, and Milner has bought them like new changing rooms. He buys them all kits, but any kids who can't afford it, he gets them boots.
Fantastic.
He's a real good advocate for Leeds as a Leeds lad, and I bet him, bottom of his heart, he'd love to come back to Leeds. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
If you're a Leeds lad and you've got that type of money, then money's not important, is it?
He's doing something very special, isn't he, at Liverpool?
He's a very, very good player.
He's incredible. But as a professional,
we need to sign him and make him captain.
You heard it here first. Not from me.
That's it. I'm a football manager. I'm a butcher. But anyway, that's that. And we'll just keep going. But hopefully we'll be going up and we'll be able to sign some real good players.
Absolutely. But the difference, I think, from where we are to where we want to go is huge. And that's the thing as well, in that, just by getting promoted, you know, that is a battle then to stay there. And then what we need, and I think where we deserve, we should be looking at that middle ground in the Premier League and then looking up. But it's a building situation in that, you know, so many gaps and steps between where we are and where we want to go.
Getting on to like community stuff and that, I have a real good affinity with a club called the Hunslet Club, mm-hmm. which I believe you're going to be.
I am.
I got you that gig.
Thank you very much.
I'm his
good
agent
man.
As well.
Good
now.
Man.
Ring anybody him wants to read anytime, for, just no speak to Phil. I'm his minder. I'm your best mate now. You know that. Yeah. You know, like we're pals now.
I can't believe I gave you my number.
You'll be getting a few texts on Saturday when I'm steaming and stuff. Don't worry about that. It's a Hunslet Club and. That's a real good place. If there were more places like that, then there'd be a lot less crime and stuff. They're real good mates of mine down there. And I'll be going myself. And my wife will be doing catering. So if you want a nice steak or out, you can have what you want on top table.
Fillet
you know
steak.
Do you like a bit of
Bernays
meat?
Sauce.
I mean, we haven't even spoke about meat. This is a meat show. But I'm not interested in football side of it. But are you a big meat fan? Do you like it?
I do like meat.
Australians
meat, yeah.
do like
and unfortunately, meat. This is a bit of a sad bit here. One of my best friends in Leeds was a butcher. Unfortunately, he's passed away.
Who was that?
Very recently. Barton, Beefy Barton.
Yeah, I know
Chris
him, yeah.
Barton.
Chris Barton, yeah. Chris he used Barton. To have a lot to do with golf clubs. He owned D&K Butchers.
That's right.
He used to do Garforth Golf Club. He used to be a buyer for BB's as well. You know, they were a real good mate of my mates, and he was a good guy. He liked to gauge, like, but he was a nice man.
Really nice. Unfortunately, he passed away. He went to his funeral last week, but a lot of Leeds lads were there.
Yeah.
And I knew him
from A lot of my pals were there. I know of him, and he knows me, and, you know, I wish his family all the best and stuff, but he definitely used to do good quality meat, a lot of catering,
absolutely.
Wholesale side of things. But, yeah, it's sad out like that, but... Sometimes it's just the way it is. Like
well, it is, yeah. So Beefy...
Popular in golf community.
He was, yeah. So Beefy used to give me fantastic cuts of meat, so I can't wait for all my meat now. I'll tell
you
what, here we go.
Well, we've got Gourmet Protein Club, and that's class for higher class people.
Gourmet Protein Club?
Yeah,
that's... What's that all about?
Well, basically, I've got four butcher shops, and I've built a business that's based on giving value. I'm from a market background, and I always want to give as much as I can to... I had it into my head anyway, that people just wanted carrier bags for as much as possible because that's what market trading's about. They want value for money. But I'm realising that I won't get in as many professional, young, up-and-coming, you know, customers of that age group, of like my age group and younger. So we teamed up with Josh and we decided to ask a few questions, reach out to a few friends, reach out to a few... people with a bit of money, mm-hmm. stuff like that. People who not got families, professional power. People with money is the wrong way of describing it, really. Just people who just don't want a load. They just want a box with mm-hmm. seven items in that's absolute quality. Mm-hmm. They're not bothered about it being cheap. They just want it right. Mm-hmm. So we've set up a Facebook group and website called the Gourmet Protein Club, and we're hoping to build a base of 1,000 customers that are interested in buying meat, that are interested in buying quality, and have a bit of an interest full stop in meat. You know, that is my passion. As I speak to you, you're Tony Drigo, Leeds United.
Talking meat.
But when it's meat, you know, like meat is my passion. That's what I am good at. But on this podcast, it'll probably all people will think I'm Leeds United, but I'm not. It's like meat, and what we're trying to do is make meat great again. That's make it fashionable. There's a few people against. There seems to be the people for and people against meat at the moment. And I ain't got not against any vegan or vegetarian. It don't matter to me. I'm only interested in people who have real affinity with it. And if you're Australian and Italian, well, them two. People, them two countries, they love the meat, don't they?
Absolutely.
Really passionate
barbecue.
About it.
Barbecue. Barbie.
Yeah. Australians, Barbie. Italians, they know how to hang it, they know how to cure it, mm-hmm. they know how to do the salamis. They have a real, real good knowledge of meat, full stop. Because that's, like now, people growing up, if they're in a label on it, are they in... cooking instructions on it, they don't know how to do it. But in Australia and Italy and generally a lot of places than England, really, Australia, in America, they're not out smoking, stuff like that. So we're just trying to get a group of people together who are interested in meat, who want to do a good job of it, and that's basically where we're at with that. So I'll sort, once I've found out your address as well as your phone number, I'll send you a packet.
Okay. P.O. box.
I'll deliver it every Saturday night about 7:30. We'll get a few cans out.
And if I'm not there, just leave it on the porch.
I'll leave it on the porch. Okay, good stuff. But yeah, that's meat job. So if you ever want to, like, what's your favourite cut?
I do like a fillet steak.
You like fillet?
I do like fillet steak.
We'll get you something that's aged.
Rack of lamb.
Rack of lamb.
I love rack of lamb. Or even the shank, lamb shank.
It's registered, it's done. I'll sell it for you.
Lovely.
How many butcher now?
No, we're bro, okay, sorted.
It's sorted. Logged.
That's it.
It's done. But like I say, we've got a few shirts that need signing. Josh, can you pass me them shirts, please? Now, the first one we're going to ask you to sign is for a mate of mine.
No problems at all. And he's, let's do a swap. Thank you.
He's taking a group of 18 kids from Lock Lane Rugby Club to France. So he's trying to raise some money. So we could do with this one signing, and then we're going to auction that one off. If anybody wants to bid on it,
okay,
all the money's going to kids from Lock Lane.
Do you want to hold that there nice and tight?
That's it.
And I'll put it there. Don't know why I love the yellow shirt. The away yellow.
He scored that belter against Man City in yellow.
I scored. Like that. Well, Sheffield Wednesday, and everyone keeps asking me about that. If you look at it on YouTube, I scored at Sheffield Wednesday. This goddamn tag keeps flapping at the back of my neck.
Yeah, you had a thing about your presentation. On
exactly.
Game day,
what's going on? But there we are.
Right, that's that one.
Done.
Can I have another one, please?
Okay.
This one is for, we did a charity night the other night, and a guy called Steve Whitaker, you might know him, he has a Comply van lining. He's got a box at Ellen Road, and they give us four seats in it to auction off.
Oh, wonderful.
So excellent. If you could put to Steve with that, please.
No problems at all.
I'm going to drop this off for him, because I asked him one favour, he did it for me straight away, no problem.
Brilliant. And I think this season, especially the hospitality, like the boxes and all that.
It's just quality, isn't
it? Yeah, absolutely.
Is Paul Reaney still doing a bit down there with it?
Well, I don't see too much of him now, but it's Terry Yorath, Norman Hunter is great. Good old
I hear
Norm
Peter Lorimer's really poorly.
Yeah, well, he has been poorly, then he gets better. And at the moment, I think he's doing okay, which is
this
great.
This one's for my mate Dame McKenna. He's just organised this charity night that we did the other night. He put a bit of work into it, so we're going to give him one of these, get this framed. He'll have it up in his office.
Okay. Okay.
Cheers.
Excellent.
And this one, you remember earlier on when I told you about my mate who wanted the kangaroo skin boots?
Yep.
And he couldn't have them.
Well, you give him this instead.
He's going to give him this instead.
Nice.
So this one's to Rob.
To Rob. Okay. Okay.
And just one more. This one, if I forget her, it's my wife's birthday tomorrow. So this one's for Sam. This is part of a present.
Part of a present? This is it. That's
it. You know
it.
What else about her?
What'd you buy?
Half share in the ground. We're calling it four sirloins for a tenner.
How much did you pay for it? Actually, how much are greyhounds? I mean, I can imagine you pay a lot.
Nah, half share were 500 quid.
Right, okay.
It's a bit of fun. It's
give you a lot of fun, yeah.
I went to see it the other day. It looked like a Labrador, to be fair, but I might have been ripped off. But, well, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for supporting us on this. And
no,
you know, that high-profile guy. And we get to this point in show every time, and we know we're after making meat great again, just like Leeds United.
Come on, then.
We need you to put the hat on.
Just like Leeds United. That's making it. Meat great again.
Leeds,
there
Leeds,
we go.
Leeds. Get on. That's it.
Right, get this off now.
Right, episode 3. Now, last week we had Luke Gale, Super League player, Man of Steel, But this week I've brought you a completely different gravy. If you're from my era, I'm from Morley. You know, everyone knows I'm from Morley. Leeds United is key. You know, over here, where we are now in Pontefract, it's a big rugby league area. But where I'm from in Morley, Leeds United, it just runs through the blood. So today we've got Tony DiRigo, best left back they've ever had, championship winner. Welcome to House. Thank you so much for coming.
More than welcome.
It's a total privilege to have you here, and wow, I can't believe you're here.
Good to be here. Good to be here.
That's what it's all about. And obviously, I want to talk to you about championship when you won it.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, we've been putting it on Facebook and stuff like that that you're coming. So a lot of my mates have been like, bloody hell, what's going on about Tony DiRigo, this, Leeds United, that. Obviously, Leeds United are in the middle of going up. You know, we're hopefully going to go up this year.
I like the way you said that, going up.
We are going up. We're not going up.
We're going up.
Can't go on forever. So, but what I wanted to ask you, first question really was, do you actually realise how in esteem people hold that era, that team? You know, Tony DiRigo, Mel Sterling, Chris Fairclough, David Batty, Gary Speed. Do you still remember it? Is it still inside you?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And I think during that season especially, obviously you're trying to win the big things, but as you're in the middle of it all, you don't realise it until probably afterwards what you've actually done. And then the feeling that, you know, the fans have given us year after year after that has been incredible. I think the difference for me especially probably recently is that the club now have really welcomed me and other ex-players back. Even more. Not saying they didn't before, but now, especially with the new owner, he's been absolutely fantastic. So we've come back, because before I was getting invited by Chelsea. Apologise. You know, Stoke City, Aston Villa, Derby, all my other clubs trying to get me back. And Leeds, not so much. And where I wanted to go was back to Leeds. So recently I've moved back to the city, and Andrea called me up and says, can you come and open the Legends Lounge? About 2 years ago this was. It was fantastic, and everyone around the club has been wonderful. Of course, things are going well now, but yeah, it's lovely to be back, and it's nice to be remembered, you know, in a great period.
Obviously, I know a lot about Tony DiRigo. I used to go, you know, 12, 13, 14, 15-year-old, go down Welland Road with my dad. You're one of my dad's favourite players. I used to sit right outside at dugout, so there'd be Peter Gumby, Mick Hennigan, Howard Wilkinson. Peter Gumby's a customer of mine.
All right, very
good. He still comes in. He texts me for a pint now and again in Leeds. We drift off and talk about football and stuff, because that era, I'm really enthusiastic about. I know for a fact when Leeds United were playing towards Kop, you were always at our side because you were left back. Why did you always wear long sleeve shirts at Leeds United? But when you played for England, they were always short sleeve. Why?
Because I couldn't get a long sleeve for England. That was why. I like long sleeve. I don't know why. It's one of my
habits. You used to wear Asics boots as well.
I did. They were kangaroo skin. That's why I could jump so high.
You know something as well? I were from... my mum and dad did the very, very best for us. But, you know, like... I thought, bloody hell, they're good, them boots. I always played rugby. And I was talking to my mate about it this week, Rob Davis. There used to be a catalogue come round it. I think it was called M&M. And it was like top quality football boots. Right. You know them boots were 200 and odd quid all that time ago?
Yeah, because they were actually in limited edition from Japan. And they were really, really light.
You and Batty and McAllister all wore the same boots. Batty at one point wore Brooks ones. I don't know, sponsor. Yeah.
Speedo, I think, wore Asics as well.
Yeah.
And the actual factory was near Leeds Bradford Airport.
Well, I definitely couldn't have a pair. But my mate Rob, he was spoiled, and even he couldn't have a pair.
They weren't cheap.
You still got any?
I haven't. But what you used to do is get like a size too small as well, and get them and just stretch them a little bit. So we end up, I'm like a size, 7 or 8 now. I'd get a 6 and squeeze into them. They'd stretch slightly.
Really surprised because, like, obviously I've been doing a bit of research this week on some stats and stuff like that. I could have swore you scored more goals for Leeds than what you did.
You know what? It's not about quantity, it's quality.
Do you know something?
That's what it's all about.
You know why I thought you'd scored a lot more?
Why?
Because when you scored one, My dad went on about it for about 14 games afterwards. So in my mind, Tariq Nego scored a few goals.
He had to go on for 14 games. They didn't score another one for a long time.
You had a good left foot. You used to do some good free kicks and stuff.
Yeah, I think, back to the championship winning side, I scored three times. One was a half volley.
That were against
Man City.
In a yellow kit.
Exactly, yeah. Right. But Bat scored.
Sweet volley, that.
Bat scored the same day.
Yeah, they did. He just did a little put and he hadn't scored for about 5 years.
Exactly. It was some little tap-in thing. I've just belted at 25 yards. The flipping cop was coming down. I thought there was an earthquake or something when Bat scored. Because he's a local lad. Honestly, it was fantastic. But I'm thinking, hello? Do you remember
dad,
my goal?
You know, so what my dad used to do as well. My dad used to, like, in that team, there were you, Mel Sterland, Gary McAllister, Gordon Strachan, all good at taking free kicks. Mm-hmm. So if any of them other three took a free kick and missed... Every time, should have let Dorigo take it.
I knew it.
What did I tell you? I told you it should have let Dorigo take it. And that, but if they ever scored, I'd say, yeah, hey, I bet you're glad he didn't take that one. He'd just on the show.
Your dad's a very smart man, I have to say.
I thought he was a genius at football, but what he used to do, any attacking position whatsoever that Leeds United have, he'd say, they're going to score you. You watch, they're going to score you. And when they did score... You're like, what did I tell you? But it took me till I was about 15 to realise. He just said it every free kick, every attack, and any attacking position Leeds had, he'd say, they're going to score on them and the sky. Say, what did I tell you? Come see your dad. I know my football.
Actually, that's like I did a thing for Ladbrokes recently, and I had to meet a fan who put on some money in the championship winning year. She bet on us to win. I'm thinking, wow, that's amazing. That's fantastic. You know, how much did you put on? Fiver. But, well, you weren't that confident, were you? Was it just that year? No, I do it every year. So, well, it's not lucky then, is it? You're just putting a fiver on every year. But she won some money anyway, so that's all right.
It's been tough being a Leeds fan over years, you know, since the decline. Like, I had the joy of being a fan when you lot were really, really good. And also the European ride, everything that went with that. But just thought, I can remember saying to my dad, you know, bloody hell, Dad, when they went down, how long do you think it'll be? And he went, it'll be 5 years, son. 5 years, it's a right mess. And what are we now, 13?
15.
15.
I think it's 15, yeah.
It's been, you know, like, that's why I say they are going up. Because if you look at any type of negative feeling about what's happened with Leeds over the years, it's been tough being a Leeds fan when I can remember it being really good. I think for my age, I'm 38, I've had some really good experience with Leeds United. I mean,
well, at least you've had ups and downs.
Yeah,
that's the thing. Unfortunately, yeah. we're on a bit of a downer now. But
well,
I think
they're
as well,
coming back now, aren't they?
No, absolutely. Were
Ken Bates, take you back to when you were at Chelsea, were Ken Bates the chairman then?
He was.
Didn't like him, did you?
We got on great, me and Ken.
Did you?
Not. problem was, I at Chelsea, when I signed for them from Aston Villa, we had some really, really good players. But Ken... thought he was the manager. Basically, he had so much input into things he shouldn't have done. So he affected the group. The manager was John Hollins, so he would affect us. And it's easy to say, well, you know, you shouldn't allow that to happen, but there's no choice. You know, he had such an effect on the club. And we could do well, or then we could do very, very badly. And I just thought, okay, we might win 6 or 7 on the trot, but then go lose 4 or 5, and something would happen in the background for that to then... all go wrong. So I just wanted to leave. After about a couple of years, I thought, right, I want to leave. Glasgow Rangers had tried to sign me month on month. I went in to see Ken Bates, asking for a transfer. That was interesting. I wrote a letter out and took it in with me and sat down and explained to Ken for about 20 minutes, you know, all the reasons why I thought we couldn't be successful. Because what did I want to do? I wanted to win something. Or you always want to think you could win something. If I was ever at a club that I thought they don't think they can win, then what am I doing there? You always want to be the best, whatever it is. So anyway, so I did this for 20 minutes with Ken. He got my contract, turned it over, and said, by the way, Tony, I think you've got 2 years left. There's the deep door. That's what
that
he said to me.
And you just
I got up and I said, I will never sign for this club again, and walked out. So I had to stay here about a year and a half. They offered me this and that and the other.
And were you not playing?
Yeah, I played every game. I played every game. They would try to get me into a new contract, but they knew the character that I was. I'm not going to not play. They needed me, so I obviously played for England, so I kept playing. But I just waited my time. Contract ran out. I was off.
Talking of writing letters, I went right back to when you even come over here. That's how you got here, innit? You wrote letters to clubs just saying, listen, I'm a good footballer, do you want me? Because you're Australian, obviously. And that's like a bit of a entrepreneur in itself, isn't it? Having the bottle. Did you just leave your mum and dad and just come over here? That's it.
I basically wrote a letter. I only had one thing in my mind. I went to, imagine going to school, and your teacher says to you, Tony, now, three professions, what would you like to do? Number one, two, and three. And this is an Aussie kid from Adelaide, and I put professional soccer player number one. I'm thinking number two. Professional soccer player, three professional soccer player. That's all I could see. That was it. And they're going, Tony, don't be stupid. You know, you're never going to be able to do that. Well, I thought I could. And if you don't think you can, then you definitely won't. So I wrote a letter to the top 12 clubs at the time in the old First Division. Leeds weren't in that top 12 at that point. And I got one reply from Aston Villa. So I was 15 years of age and they gave me a four-day trial. I came over with my dad for 4 days to Birmingham. And that was it. 2-3 weeks later, they signed me as a schoolboy. Year after, I was as an apprentice. Year after that, early as a pro, 17 and a half. And 18, I was in the first team.
Bloody hell. Mm. But obviously, with teams you've played for, and you don't, you can tell me truth here, don't you? Is Leeds your team? Because you're from Australia, you know, it's not like me. I have to support Leeds. If I had supported Leeds, I'd have been... If I'd have come home and said, well, as it goes, Dad, I want to support, like, anyone, like Liverpool, it'd have been, well, just get your stuff and get out.
Well, I'll tell you a true, true story here. Now, I was from Adelaide. I support Adelaide City, my local team. Okay. My father is Italian. My mother's Australian. Now, my father's born from... Udinese, so that's the team that he supported, but he then supported an English side. And he kept telling me for years it was Leeds United. And I, but so my father, being an Italian, supported Leeds United. Why? Because he went out to Australia late 60s, early 70s, and of course Leeds were always on the TV, and he fell in love with their style. He was quite a strong player himself. He played as well. But I was laughing at him at the time because Leeds weren't right up there, you know, when I started kind of coming through. And lo and behold, to then turn it all around, to come to Leeds, to win the title with my dad's team, is just... It's bizarre. It's absolutely bizarre. It really is. So now I look back at all the teams I played for. Aston Villa, I'm so grateful they gave me my chance. A wonderful, wonderful club. Chelsea, they're not the club... that they are now. When I was there, fans were so diehard and, you know, wonderful, but just outside the club for me was the problem. But I enjoyed it. The last couple of years, it was you know, a bit more difficult. But again, we won the old second division title. I scored a winner at Wembley in one of the cup finals, so I have great memories of that. But Leeds is where I was really successful, and it certainly is. I always look for Leeds first, absolutely.
Yeah, good. I mean, I was looking. I was doing a bit more research, and like when you were at Chelsea, you got player of the year.
Mm-hmm.
When you were at Leeds United and the one title, you were player of the year, mm-hmm. which a lot of people won't know that. Before I found out that fact, I'd have hazarded a guess at Gordon Strachan or something. But didn't you get player of the year at Derby as well?
I actually got player of the year at Torino.
Torino, yeah.
And Aston Villa, my first club as well.
Do you speak Italian, mate? Do you learn all right over
I do now. I learn, obviously, all the swear words first. It's always helpful, that is, when you go over. All the swear words. Then the football words. I was only there for 1 year with Graeme Souness at Torino. But had a fantastic experience. But yeah, I was fortunate. A fullback to get player of the year at kind of every club. When I got to Derby.
Yeah, fullback to get player of the year. That's what I say, you know, you were very consistent, good player for Leeds, and it's good that now they've got your back. I see a lot of photographs on hospitality, blah, 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 blah. And they do have, that's why I say to you, like, do you understand? Because if me and you went for a pint in Marley now, within 25 minutes, it would have got round, and every pub would be full. Three goes in Queens.
It's good. And that's why I look at Leeds and the city itself and the fans and the owners now and everyone associated with the club. I'm thinking, oh, come on. Premier League, you know, that's where we got to be.
Oh.
We got to be in the Premier League, and I'm excited this season.
There's nothing quite like the atmosphere at Elland Road. I mean, one of my best mates, he supports Man City, so he says, "Listen, I got a spare ticket. Will you come with us?" And I went with him. I've only ever been to Headingley for rugby league and Elland Road for football. And I was shocked. I'm like, what's up with them? Well, Leeds United's like, it's just mental, isn't
well,
it?
Well, it's funny. It's like when I end up going to Derby. And Derby, a lovely club, but they're supporters. You know, you listen to the songs that they sing. And then I never forget this one song, whatever game we were playing, you know, and all the fans are there and they go, "Let's go, Derby, let's go." I'm thinking, oh, come on, let's do something a bit more than that. That's not going to get me going. You know what I mean? Whereas Leeds, they want to rip your head off. That
Leeds,
that's
it
what you
just
want.
Makes,
that's what you
it
want.
Makes airs on back of your neck stand
exactly.
up. It
has to.
Do you know what I mean? I'm at moment, I can't tell no lies. I work on Saturdays, me, and I don't go to a lot of Leeds United games because I'm just like work orientated. But I am hunting upside down for a ticket for Villa game end because to be at Elland Road, and it's about the Villa game where we'll know if we're up or not, and it's looking tight. But I mean, we're still sitting pretty. But the atmosphere, and I mean, I've moved over to Pontefract from Morley, but I guarantee you, on the day that Leeds United are announced that they're going up to the Premiership, I will be on Cherwell Hill. It'll be absolutely nice. I can remember when they won title. Me and my mates were all in park. We were like running around. We nicked a bed sheet and we went down to Elland Road. And I mean, what did you lot do that night when you won? Did you have a party somewhere or something?
Well, the thing is that day, I was on the Sunday.
Because you could have had the lads, freedom of the city. You could have done anything you wanted, couldn't you?
Me and Bats had to go with England.
Oh.
We were supposed to then travel and play Russia. And so we were playing a friendly over in Russia. So I was on my way down to my in-laws and then going down to meet up with England. Bats was ready to do the same on the Monday. We get a phone call from Howard Wilkinson that night. So 4 or 5 hours after, we'd obviously the result went our way and we'd won the title. He was half cut. To be fair, so was I. And we had this mumbling conversation. And he said, "Tony, don't worry. You don't have to go to England if you don't want. I've talked to the manager. You can stay and celebrate with the rest of the lads. You know, I've talked to Bats as well." I said, "Right, I'm staying." And that was it. So I had to get in my car and whiz back to Leeds. So Monday, then we all met up and had a, yeah.
My wife's dad, Eric, who's passed away also, he used to sell all scarves, hats, you know, all that stuff outside Lowfield Road Tunnel and also on that pitch and outside Peacock Pub.
Yeah.
And he was telling me, like, so when they won title, lad, you could have had all you want. You know, like, when I started going out with Sam, it says, that year they won title, you could have all you want. He said, we went on 5 holidays that year.
it was
so
incredible.
And that's why if we do go up to, you know, when we get up to the Premiership, it'll be just so good for City, it'll be good for hotels, it'll be good for everything.
It's
Leeds is
right.
A destination.
No, it is, and I think if we are the third biggest city in England. If you think of all the businesses moving in, and I've been away and I've come back, in the last couple of years, the centre of Leeds is fantastic. Where is there a city with so much quality in a compact, you know, environment? It's wonderful. So, yeah, I think as soon as we do go up, wow. It's going to absolutely take off. And I'm thinking, we're already sold out every week. The club shop is doing crazy numbers. The fans, the sponsors, it's brilliant. When we get up, imagine what's happening.
We went this week to get 5 Evening Post retro kits for you to sign in a minute. And I got talking to the lad in there, because as you can imagine, I talk a bit. And
no way.
He says, this club shop now takes more than Man City one now. So imagine what they'll do. Because I noticed there were, I always look about retail stuff and I'm like, there's 29 tills in here. 29. I went, do you open them all? Everybody went on match day. Every single one's flying and they're queuing out the door. He says, you like that? Mm. It's unbelievable. Like, can I ask you another question, right? If you explain this, how come, if you were a big billionaire guy now, why would you not pick Leeds before any other? Why? I don't get it.
Now, I think you're right. Now we are so ripe. I think if you go back a few years, clearly the issues underlying and underpinning the club, we had so many issues, did we not? What, you know, why are we where we are? The owners that we've had and how we got rid of the stadium and this, that and
just
the other.
Puzzling.
It is. But now I think we've got an owner that's put proper structure in place, bought the ground back. You know, the brand now is all very, very important. He understands. You know, he listens to the fans as well. I think if you're, not that he wants to sell, and I hope he certainly doesn't, but you're quite right. Any billionaire now, I'd be thinking, oh, that's the one for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
and I know what kind of Newcastle people are trying to buy Newcastle and what that's looking at going for. I'm thinking, are you kidding me? Leeds. Well, Leeds. Leeds, you know.
When Leeds were in state of, you know, real bad times at Leeds, I cannot work out why some... that say the guy who owns Man City, money's no object to him. Anybody. I mean, like the guy who bought Leicester. Who, in the right mind, would buy Leicester before Leeds? I don't get it.
And look what he's done, though. I mean, he's but he's come in and helped the city. Absolutely amazing. But you're right. But you're right. But I do
it's not against any other team, Leicester or anybody who's been taken over. But I just look at it from a business point of view. And if there were a club in country that I were going to buy, it'd be Leeds United. End of. That would be it. And that isn't because I'm a Leeds fan. It's just, there's even room for development at side at ground. There's run down. It's just ripe for absolute development. It puzzles me.
But I think if you go back 15 years and the people that kept coming in, they probably thinking the same thing. That, you know what, I can easily make a bit of money here. And they did make some money, but nothing was, I think, for the long-standing health of the club. Absolutely not. So now I think we've got that happening. And that's really important because the value of, imagine if we go up, the value of our club is going to be worth God knows what. And as a brand, I mean, Bournemouth, okay, they're in the Premier League. You know, can they suddenly light up all their fans around the world? No, they can't.
Can they?
They haven't got any. We have.
You don't realize
we've got them all around the place. So
when I'm working in my shop in Leeds, on match day, the amount of foreign people, I mean, we're really big in like Norway, Iceland, Republic of Ireland, Northern Ireland. There's loads and loads of people on a day out round Leeds that are just, because we have a scarf at shop, this and over, and they're like, Leeds United, Leeds United. We have a bit of crap with them. You won't believe how big it is, Leeds United.
No, absolutely.
And talking of value, I'm not going to put you on spot here because it's not a fair question, but what I want the viewers to text in, how much on today's market does a 25-year-old Tony DiRigo command as one, value in signing him, and two, what's he worth in getting paid?
I think I
won't ask that to you. Because
don't ask me.
Really,
however, if anyone would like to buy me or pay me that amount of money, I'll pass on my number willingly. No problems at all. Even give me a tenth of it. It's absolutely
fine.
Leeds
signed you for $1.3 million.
Bargain.
I'd never, ever, ever ask like what your wage is. Well, it's not fair, that. But when you look at some of the players today, do you ever just think to yourself, bastard?
Something like that, yeah. I don't want to swear. Mother, could you not have waited a little bit longer or something? Yeah. You know what? I look back now and I don't actually think like that. In reality, I really don't, because I just...
No, you've got to be looking for what you've had, I suppose.
Exactly. I'm delighted with what I have. And a lot of people, same sort of thing with the money side of things, but some people talk to me about England caps and said, and then Stuart Pearce. And Stuart Pearce, good friend of mine, but I don't look like that either. I say, you only got 15 caps. Only. I am delighted I got 15 caps. You know, I feel... very.
Let me tell you something.
Proud
about,
for 15 caps, not that I could have got 67.
You not being in the England team was the butt of many of argument in our household, because we used to be there and like the announced team, it'd be like, say Peter Shilton, Paul Parker, number 3, Stuart Pearce, and when they named Stuart Pearce, instantly my dad'd be like, I don't believe it. They picked him again. They picked him again, Stuart Pearce. He's shit. He's not as good as DiRigo. And let me tell you this. Let me tell you now. He never even smiles. What's him smiling got to do with playing for England? He's in the team.
Like, your dad is smart.
You know what? He's passed now, but even when he scored against Spain in that penalty shootout, my dad turned around. Everybody else in country is running like this. My dad says, he's lucky, because if it were for me, he wouldn't even be in the team. DiRigo beat team.
Brilliant.
You're not even English. He's Australian. But yeah, I used to watch England games in another room, because it didn't be that what butt of conversation, unless you were playing, of course.
Obviously.
Who were the nicest manager you ever played under?
Nicest manager? God, I played under a lot of different ones. Bobby Robson was wonderful.
Have you watched that documentary on Netflix about him?
I haven't.
Brilliant. There's a film about him called... it's just called Robson. And obviously, football's terms, I just... I just support Leeds. I know about Leeds and I watch a bit. But I watched that, and what a lovely, lovely man he was. And I tell you what, it's worth a watch if you're a football fan, on just for fact of like how successful he was. Like, you were a successful player, and it's a lot of it's under radar. That man, what he did at Barcelona.
Well, Barcelona, exactly. Wow. With England. And I think the respect that we all had for him was just amazing. He gave me my first cap. But just how he made you feel important and valued and wanted was tremendous.
I mean, he found the original Ronaldo, didn't he? Like, he went and found him, brought him. That Robson documentary, if you're a football enthusiast, which I'm a rugby league man. I'm not going to lie to you, but I do follow football. I'm not as bothered about it now. But when I was a kid and stuff, I was right into... But that era, I mean, like, imagine if he'd have been in charge of Paul Gascoigne for all of his life. He just knew how to deal with people, didn't he?
He did, but when you mentioned Paul Gascoigne, I think no one could deal with Gazza.
Yeah.
I roomed with him.
It's a shame, isn't it?
Once, never again.
Never.
Nightmare. Joking, an absolute nightmare. And there's no... And I can't tell you all those stories, but I think... Gazza was incredible. He was the best player that I've ever played with. Absolutely. Natural talent, you know, by a long way. When you've got the best players in the country with England, you know, training together, and you see someone has more time and more space and his head and shoulders above everyone else. He was incredible. But I know what you mean. In that, if someone got the best out of him and he could look after himself in the right way for that 10-12 year period, he would have been one of the, you know, the best
in
the
world. I once read a bit about Alex Ferguson. I mean, I know a lot of Leeds fans hate Alex Ferguson, I understand, but he actually went on vacation, presuming he'd signed Paul Gascoigne, didn't he? So he'd literally said to Paul Gascoigne, said to his agent, everything, it were all nailed on, right, shall I go on holiday, Charter? You know, you've definitely got him signed, haven't you? He's definitely coming. Everything were agreed verbally. He went on holiday. And while he went on holiday, Gazza went down to Tottenham. Tottenham bought his mum and dad a house or something, I believe, and said it'd be a great investment, and they signed him. And it'd be just interesting to see what Gazza would have been like under somebody like him's guidance.
I think it would have been his biggest challenge.
Yeah.
Fergie managed characters really well, but Gazza would have been something else. But we'll never know. I never know, but what a player.
Did he ever come sniffing around you, Ferguson? Because he liked every other good Leeds player.
Manchester United looked at me years and years ago when I was at Aston Villa. Instead of that, I went to Chelsea.
You wouldn't have been able to come here today if you'd have ever played for them.
I understand. So isn't that lucky? That's very fortunate. I saw the light eventually and I came to the right place. All good.
Yeah, you wouldn't have been doing hospitality at Elland Road now if you'd played. I mean, you know something? My old man didn't fully trust Gordon Strachan because he'd played for them. He liked McAllister, but...
there was something about Strack that wasn't quite right.
I tell you what, he was a good player, though.
A great player.
Well, that's what Leeds need now, in my opinion. Somebody at that age. You know, it would be good to come back to Leeds now and be the perfect...
Milner.
Yes.
There you go.
Yes,
I could see that
exactly
one.
Exactly what I was going to say.
I could see that one all day long. Hernandez now is doing a job now with that experience and quality for this side. But you're right, when we...
The lad who works with me, Ashley, his sons play at Horsforth, and Milner, he's bought them like new changing rooms, he buys them all kits, but any kids who can't afford it, he gets them boots.
Fantastic.
He's a real good advocate for Leeds as a Leeds lad, and I bet him, bottom of his heart, he'd love to come back to Leeds. He'll want, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
If you're a Leeds lad and you've got that type of money, then... money is not important, is it?
But he's doing something very special, isn't he, at Liverpool?
He's a very, very good player.
He's incredible. But yeah, as a professional, as a
if we go up, we need to sign him and make him captain.
There you go. You heard it here first. Not from me, from him.
That's it. I'm a football manager. I'm a butcher. But anyway, that's that. And we'll just keep going. But hopefully we'll be going up and we'll be able to sell some real good players.
Absolutely, but the difference, I think, from where we are to where we want to go is huge. And that's the thing as well, in that just by getting promoted, you know, that is a battle then to stay there. And then what we need, and I think where we deserve, we should be looking at that middle ground in the Premier League and then looking up. But it's a building situation in that, you know, so many gaps and steps between where we are and where we want to go.
getting on to like community stuff and that, I have a real good affinity with a club called Hunslet Club, mm-hmm. which I believe you're going to be.
I
got you that gig.
Thank you very much.
I'm his good agent
man.
As well.
Good
now.
Man. Ring
anybody
him
wants to read anytime, off, just no speak to Phil. All. I'm his minder. I'm like, yeah, I'm your best mate now. You know that, don't you? You're like, I mean, we're pals now.
I can't believe it. I gave you my number.
You'll be getting a few texts on Saturday on Steaming and stuff. Don't worry about that. It's a Hunslet Club and. That's a real good place. If there were more places like that, then there'd be a lot less crime and stuff. They're real good mates of mine down there. And I'll be going myself. And my wife will be doing catering. So if you want a nice steak or out, you can have what you want on top table.
Fillet
you know
steak.
Do you like a bit of
Bernays
meat?
Sauce.
I mean, we haven't even spoke about meat. This is a meat show. But I'm not interested in the football side of it. But are you a big meat fan? Do you like
I do like feet.
Australians
meat, yeah.
do know.
And unfortunately, this is a bit of a sad bit here. One of my best friends in Leeds was a butcher. Unfortunately, he's passed away.
Who was that?
Very recently. Barton, Beefy Barton.
Yeah, I know
Chris
him, yeah.
Barton.
Chris Barton, yeah. Chris he used Barton. To have a lot to do with golf clubs. He owned D&K Butchers.
That's right.
He used to do Garforth Golf Club. He used to be buyer for Beebe's as well. You know, a real good mate of my mates, and he was a good guy. He liked to gauge, but he was a nice man.
Really nice. Unfortunately, he passed away. He went to his funeral last week, but a lot of Leeds lads were there.
Yeah.
And I knew him
a lot of my pals were there. Yeah. A lot of my pals were there. I know of him, and he knows me, and I wish his family all the best and stuff, but he definitely used to do good quality meat, a lot of catering,
absolutely.
Wholesale side of things, but yeah, it's sad out like that, but sometimes it's just the way it is.
Well, it is, yeah. So
popular
Beef,
in golf community.
He was, yeah. So Beef used to give me fantastic cuts of meat, so I can't wait for all my meat now. I'll
tell
you what, here we go.
Well, we've got Gourmet Protein Club, and that's class for higher class people.
Protein Club?
Yeah.
What's that all about?
Well, basically, I've got four butcher shops, and I've built a business that's based on giving value. I'm from a market background, and I always want to give as much as I can to... I had it into my head anyway that people just wanted carrier bags for as much as possible because that's what market trading's about. They want value for money. But I'm realising that I won't get in as many professional, young, up-and-coming, customers of that age group, of like my age group and younger. So we teamed up with Josh and we decided to ask a few questions, reach out to a few friends, reach out to a few... people with a bit of money, mm-hmm. stuff like that. People who not got families, professional people with money is the wrong way of describing it, really. Just people who just don't want a load, they just want a box with mm-hmm. seven items in that's absolute quality. Mm-hmm. They're not bothered about it being cheap, they just want it right. Mm-hmm. So we've set up a Facebook group and website called the Gourmet Protein Club, and we're hoping to build a base of 1,000 customers that are interested in buying meat, that are interested in buying quality, and have a bit of an interest full stop in meat. That is my passion. As I speak to you, you're Tony Drigo, Leeds United.
Talking meat.
But when it's meat, meat is my passion. That's what I am good at. But on this podcast, it'll probably all people think I'm Leeds United, but I'm not. It's like meat, and what we're trying to do is make meat great again. That's make it fashionable. There's a few people against. There seems to be the people for and people against meat at the moment. And I ain't got no against any vegan or vegetarian. It don't matter to me. I'm only interested in people who have real affinity with it. And if you're Australian and Italian, well, them two countries, they love the meat, don't they?
Absolutely.
Really passionate
barbecue.
About it.
Barbecue. Barbie.
Yeah. Australians, Barbie. Italians, they know how to hang it. They know how to cure it. Mm-hmm. They know how to do the salamis. They have a real, real good knowledge of meat. Full stop. Because that's, like now, people growing up, if they're in a label on it, or they're in... cooking instructions on it, they don't know how to do it. But in Australia and Italy and generally a lot of places than England, really, in America, they're not out smoking, stuff like that. So we're just trying to get a group of people together who are interested in meat, who want to do a good job of it, and that's basically where we're at with that. So I'll sort once I've found out your address as well as your phone number, I'll send you a packet.
Okay. P.O. box.
I'll deliver it every Saturday night about 7:30. We'll get a few cans out.
And if I'm not there, just leave it on the porch.
I'll leave it on the porch. Good stuff. But that's that meat job. So if you ever want to, like, what's your favourite cut?
I do like a fillet steak.
You like fillet?
I do like fillet steak.
We'll get you something that's aged.
Rack of lamb.
Rack of lamb.
I love rack of lamb. Or even the shank, lamb shank.
It's registered, it's done. I'll sell it for you.
Lovely.
I'm your butcher now.
No, bro, about. Okay, sorted.
It's logged.
That's it.
It's done. But like I say, we've got a few shirts that need signing. Josh, can you pass me them shirts, please? Now, the first one we're going to ask you to sign, it's for a mate of mine.
No problems at all. Let's do a swap. Thank you.
He's taking a group of 18 kids from Loch Lane Rugby Club to France. So he's trying to raise some money. So we could do with this one signing, and then we're going to auction that one off if anybody wants to bid on it.
Okay.
All the money's going to kids from Loch Lane.
Do you want to hold that there nice and tight?
That's it.
And I'll put it there. Don't know why I love the yellow shirt. The away yellow.
You scored that belter against Man City in yellow.
I scored.
Like that.
Well, Sheffield Wednesday, and everyone keeps asking me about that. If you look at it on YouTube, I scored at Sheffield Wednesday. This goddamn tag keeps flapping at the back of my neck.
Yeah, you had a thing about your presentation.
Exactly.
Game day,
what's going on? But there we are.
Right, that's
right,
that one.
Done.
Can I have another one, please?
Okay.
This one is for, we did a charity night other night, and a guy called Steve Whitaker, you might know him, he has a Comply van lining, he's got a box at Ellen Road, and they give us four seats in it to auction off.
Wonderful.
So excellent. If you could put to Steve with that, please.
No problems at all.
I'm going to drop this off for him, because I asked him one favour, he did it for me straight away, no problem.
Brilliant. And I think this season, especially the hospitality, like the boxes and all that.
It's quality, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is Paul Reaney still doing a bit down there with it?
Well, I don't see too much of him now, but it's Terry Yorath. Norman Hunter is great. Good.
I hear Peter Lorimer's really poorly.
Yeah, well, he has been poorly, then he gets better. And at the moment, I think he's doing okay, which is
this
great.
This one's for my mate Dame McKenna. He's just organised this charity night that we did the other night. He put a bit of work into it. So we're going to give him one of these, get this framed. He'll have it up in his office.
Okay. Okay.
Cheers.
Excellent.
And this one, you remember earlier on when I told you about my mate who wanted the kangaroo skin boots?
Yep.
And he couldn't have them.
Oh, you give him this instead?
He's going to give him this instead.
Nice.
So this one's to Rob.
To Rob. Okay. Okay.
And just one more. This one, if I forget her, it's my wife's birthday tomorrow. So this one's for Sam. This is part of a present.
Part of a present? This is it. That's
you know
it.
What else about her?
Would you
half share in a ground. We're calling it four sirloins for a tenner.
How much did you pay for it? Actually, how much are greyhounds? I mean, I can make you pay a lot.
Nah, half share were 500 quid.
Right, okay.
It were. It's a bit of fun. It's
give you a lot of fun,
bit.
Yeah.
I went to see it the other day. It looked like a Labrador, to be fair. But I might have been ripped off. But, well, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for supporting us on this. And
no
you know, high-profile guy. And we get to this point in show every time, and we know we're after making meat great again. Like, just like Leeds United.
Come on, then.
We need you to put the hat on.
Just like Leeds United.
That's
making
it.
Meat great again.
Leeds,
there
Leeds,
we
Leeds,
go.
Leeds. Get on. That's it.
Right, get this off now.